The vast emptiness of southeastern Utah stretched out before Jana North as she drove her father's 1971 Chevrolet Nova along the desolate Highway 56. The sun had long set, and the darkness was thick, broken only by the occasional glimmer of a distant star. In the passenger seat sat Carol Abbott, her best friend, while Lisa Rockefort and Bethany Gordon, their dorm mates, relaxed in the back. The four girls were anxious, knowing they were cutting it close to curfew. Mrs. Mortensen, their house mother, always locked the dorm doors promptly at midnight, and it was already after 10 p.m. The journey had been uneventful so far, just miles of arid desert, with sagebrush, ocotillo, and patches of Spanish bayonet marking the landscape. Red sandstone bluffs loomed on the northern horizon, like silent sentinels watching over the barren land. But as they approached the small railroad crossing at Medina, Jana noticed something strange, two roads leading off from the highway. One veered sharply southeast, while the other wound its way northeast toward the distant canyons. "Which way do we go?" Carol asked, squinting at the unfamiliar sight. "Left," Jana replied without hesitation. Cedar City was somewhere to the northeast, and she figured the canyon road would cut off some time. It seemed logical, even though there had been rumors about Gadianton Canyon, the dark shadow on the horizon. The name alone carried a sense of dread. Tales of people getting lost, disappearing, or encountering strange phenomena circulated in whispers. But Jana didn't believe in such stories, and neither did the other girls. They were too focused on making it back in time to care. They turned off the highway and onto the narrow canyon road, the Nova's engine purring steadily. The dark rock walls of the canyon seemed to inch closer as they drove deeper into the foreboding landscape. The road twisted and turned, hugging the edges of sheer cliffs. The girls were in high spirits, laughing and chatting about their day, but Jana started to feel uneasy. There was something unnatural about the road. The way it bent and curved was too sharp, too disorienting. A few minutes later, the change came suddenly. The white lines on the asphalt disappeared, and the blacktop beneath the Nova's tires had turned into smooth white cement. The eerie realization dawned on Jana, and she slammed her foot down on the brakes, her heart pounding. "Jana, up ahead!" Carol shouted, pointing at the looming rock wall in front of them. The road ended abruptly, with nowhere else to go but straight into solid stone. Jana cranked the steering wheel hard, narrowly avoiding a crash. "What the hell is this?" she muttered, eyes wide with disbelief. They were boxed in. The only option was to turn around and retrace their steps. "Great, now we're really screwed," Bethany grumbled from the back seat. "We're going to miss curfew." Jana pulled the car into reverse, her hands trembling on the wheel. She tried to calm herself. It was just a wrong turn. They'd head back to Medina, get back on Highway 56, and be at the dorm before Mrs. Mortensen locked them out. No big deal. But as they drove back, the uneasiness grew. The canyon seemed different. The walls, once towering and imposing, now receded, and the desert opened up again. Yet something was very, very wrong. Instead of the familiar desert landscape they had come through, they found themselves driving past vast fields of wheat, stretching as far as the eye could see. To their left, a large dike rose, lined with ponderosa pine trees, and in the distance, a shimmering lake reflected the light of the moon. "What, where are we?" Carol whispered, her voice tinged with disbelief. "We must have gotten turned around," Jana said, though even she didn't believe it. They should have been back in the desert, but this place, it felt entirely alien. It wasn't just the landscape. The air felt different. Heavy, oppressive, like they were trespassing in a place they didn't belong. "There's no way this is Utah," Lisa said, her eyes wide with fear. The girls' confusion turned to panic when they spotted a large building up ahead, its parking lot illuminated by a neon sign. The sign's symbols were unreadable, twisted shapes and curlicues that made no sense. It wasn't any language they recognized. "I don't like this," Bethany muttered from the back seat. "This doesn't feel right." Without warning, several tall figures emerged from the building. At first, they seemed human, but as they drew closer, it became clear that something was wrong. They were too tall, their limbs too long, their movements unnatural. And their faces, distorted, twisted into expressions of fear and shock as they spotted the Nova pulling into the parking lot. "Lisa, don't," Jana warned as Lisa began rolling down her window. "I'm just going to ask for directions," Lisa said, still trying to act casual. But the men outside the building were growing more frantic, waving their arms, shouting in a language none of the girls could understand. "Let's get out of here," Carol hissed, her eyes wide with terror. The people, if they were people, were now pointing at the car, their voices rising in what could only be described as panic. "Go!" Bethany screamed. Jana didn't need to be told twice. She slammed her foot down on the gas, and the Nova tore out of the parking lot, tires squealing on the cement. As they sped away, lights flared up behind them. Strange, egg-shaped vehicles with tricycle wheels appeared from nowhere, chasing them down the road. They whirred and buzzed, their single headlights cutting through the darkness as they gained on the Chevy. "They're catching up," Lisa cried, her voice high with fear. Jana's hands gripped the wheel as she pushed the Nova to its limits, the speedometer climbing toward 80 miles per hour. The canyon walls rose up again, and the Chevy careened through the tight turns, dust billowing behind them. But the egg-shaped cars were relentless, closing the gap with each passing second. "I can't shake them," Jana shouted, her heart racing. The road twisted once more, leading them deeper into the canyon. For a moment, the strange vehicles disappeared behind a cloud of dust. But the reprieve was short-lived. As they exited the canyon, the road vanished completely, leaving them on open desert sand. The Nova bucked wildly as it tore through the brush. Jana fought to keep control, but it was no use. The car hit a dip in the terrain, skidding out of control and crashing into a shallow arroyo. For a long, terrifying moment, there was only silence. When the girls finally crawled out of the wrecked car, the world around them was eerily still. They were back in the desert, the familiar landscape of Utah stretching out before them. But the damage was done. Three of the tires were flat, and the car was undrivable. Lisa sat down on the ground, shaking and muttering to herself. "They weren't human, they weren't human." Jana stood beside the wreck, staring out at the horizon. Somehow, they had crossed into another world, another time, one they barely escaped from. At sunrise, they walked south, eventually finding their way back to Highway 56. Hours later, a Utah Highway Patrol cruiser pulled over to help them. The officer, Trooper Victoria Lindquist, listened to their story with skepticism, but when they pointed out the strange details, how there were no tracks leading to the crash site, how the road had simply disappeared, she couldn't explain it. No one could. The incident became a local legend, whispered among truckers and late-night drivers along Highway 56. And though the girls returned to their dorm, they never forgot the strange night when they took the wrong road near Gadianton Canyon, a road that shouldn't have existed at all. Gadianton Canyon, a canyon that never truly existed at all. And a legacy with no living witnesses. In this world.